So we are going to study the last verse of chapter 14, which is 14.27. Brahmano hi pratishtham amritasya vyasya cha shashvatasya cha dharmasya sukhasya ikantikasya cha. Word by word translation. Brahmanaha, of the impersonal Brahma Jyoti, he certainly pratishtha, the rest, aham, I am, amritasya, of the immortal, avyayasya, of the imperishable, cha, also, shashvatasya, of the eternal, cha, and dharmasya, of the constitutional position, sukhasya, of happiness, ekantikasya, ultimate, cha, also. Translation and purport by Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. And I am the basis of the impersonal Brahman, which is immortal, imperishable and eternal, and is the constitutional position of ultimate happiness. Purport. The constitution of Brahman is immortality, imperishability, eternity and happiness. Brahman is the beginning of transcendental realization. Paramatma, the super soul, is the middle, the second stage in transcendental realization. And the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the ultimate realization of the Absolute Truth. Therefore, both Paramatma and the impersonal Brahman are within the Supreme Person. It is explained in the 7th chapter that material nature is the manifestation of the inferior energy of the Supreme Lord. The Lord impregnates the inferior material nature with fragments of the superior nature, and that is the spiritual touch in the material nature. When a living entity conditioned by this material nature begins the cultivation of spiritual knowledge, he elevates himself from the position of material existence and gradually rises up to the Brahman conception of the Supreme. This attainment of the Brahman conception of life is the first stage in self-realization. At this stage, the Brahman realized person is transcendental to the material position, but he is not actually perfect in Brahman realization. If he wants, he can continue to stay in the Brahman position and then gradually rise up to Paramatma realization and then to the realization of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. There are many examples of this in Vedic literature. The four Kumaras were situated first in the impersonal Brahman conception of truth, but then they gradually rose to the platform of devotional service. One who can't elevate himself beyond the impersonal conception of Brahman runs the risk of falling down. In Srimad Bhagavatam, it is stated that although a person may rise to the stage of impersonal Brahman without going further, with no information of the Supreme Person, his intelligence is not perfectly clear. Therefore, in spite of being raised to the Brahman platform, there is the chance of falling down if one is not engaged in the devotional service of the Lord. In the Vedic language, it is also said, raso vaisaha, rasam hya evayam labdhva nandi bhavati. When one understands the personality of Godhead, the reservoir of pleasure, Krishna, he actually becomes transcendentally blissful. Taittiriya Upanishad 2.7.1. The Supreme Lord is full in six opulences, and when a devotee approaches him, there is an exchange of these six opulences. The servant of the king enjoys on an almost equal level with the king, and so eternal happiness, imperishable happiness, and eternal life accompany devotional service. Therefore, realization of Brahman or eternity or imperishability is included in devotional service. This is already possessed by a person who is engaged in devotional service. The living entity, although Brahman by nature, has the desire to lord it over the material world. And due to this, he falls down. In his constitutional position, a living entity is above the three modes of material nature. But association with material nature entangles him in the different modes of material nature: goodness, passion, and ignorance. Due to the association of these three modes, his desire to dominate the material world is there. By engagement in devotional service in full Krishna consciousness, he is immediately situated in the transcendental position, and his unlawful desire to control material nature is removed. Therefore, the process of devotional service, beginning with hearing, chanting, remembering the prescribed nine methods for realizing devotional service, should be practiced in the association of devotees. Gradually, by such association, by the influence of the spiritual master, one's material desire to dominate is removed, and one becomes firmly situated in the Lord's transcendental loving service. This method is prescribed from the 22nd to the last verse of this chapter. Devotional service to the Lord is very simple. One should always engage in the service of the Lord, should eat the remnants of foodstuffs offered to the deity, smell the flowers offered to the lotus feet of the Lord, see the places where the Lord had his transcendental pastimes, read of the different activities of the Lord, his reciprocation of love with his devotees, chant always the transcendental vibration, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, and observe the fasting days commemorating the appearance and disappearances of the Lord and his devotees. By following such a process, one becomes completely detached from all material activities. One who can thus situate himself in the Brahma Jyoti, or the different varieties of Brahman conception, is equal to the Supreme Personality of Godhead in quality. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports to the 14th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavad Gita in the matter of the three modes of material nature. Om Jnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamsha He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanusute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyasya Kripa Sindhubhyayavacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामीति नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्ण पहले हम पढ़ लेंगे इसको हाँ उसके बाद में यदि कुछ आपको प्रश्न है ठीक है सो वी आर हियर इन द 14th चैप्टर एट द एंड द थ्री मोड्स ऑफ मटेरियल नेचर दिस इज द लास्ट वर्स And this verse is talking about the ultimate goal of life. Having described the three modes, the characteristics and symptoms of these three modes of nature in various verses previously, then Arjun asks a question to the Lord, how can one transcend these modes and get out of it? Because we are bound by this satoguna, rajoguna and tamoguna, the mode of goodness, mode of passion and mode of ignorance. All of us in this world, we are bound by this. These three modes, they keep us bounded in this material world. So Arjuna asked that question, how can one get out of it? Then Lord Krishna describes from verse 22 to 25, those four verses, and also 26, that these are the methods by which one can get out of it. And one can attain to the Brahman stage, which is beyond this material world. A state of consciousness beyond this material world. Brahma Bhuyaya Kalpate. And then we are here in today's verse, then Lord Krishna is talking about what is that Brahman. So before we dwell into this verse, let us understand a few things. Broadly speaking, in this world, there are two types of people, if we broadly categorize. One, those who are materialists, and others transcendentalists. We can call also spiritualists. Materialists means those who are after sense gratification. They have so many desires in this world and they are running after them, trying to fulfill the desire for money, the desire for name and fame, the desire for bodily pleasures. The list goes on. So that category is the majority in this world. Everyone is after material happiness. They are looking for happiness from things in this world. So that category is materialist, where they have not understood anything yet that they are different from this body. They are soul. They consider this body to be everything. And they try to make all efforts to keep this body happy and healthy. That is the category of most of the people. They have no understanding that this body is different and I am different. I am soul living in this body for a certain period of time. After some time, I will have to leave this body and move on to another body. This understanding very few people have. So those who have this understanding, then they start making some efforts about what is life beyond this world, what happens after death, what about next life, who is God, what is my relationship with God. So they start inquiring into these questions, and this category of people, they are called spiritualists or transcendentalists. So is this too clear? Now among materialists, there are many subcategories. Based on different modes of nature, they can be classified differently. Some are highly influenced by tamoguna. Some are very much into mode of passion. Some are in mode of goodness and in mixed combinations and all that. So I am not going to dwell in that category too much today. Rather, we are going to look into the second category, which is the category of transcendentalists. And it has been described in Srimad Bhagavatam, and in this verse, in the purport also, they are also classified in three broad categories. In Srimad Bhagavatam, first canto, second chapter, these three types of transcendentalists have been classified as Brahman realized persons, and then Paramatma realized persons, and then Bhagavan realized persons. Vadanti tat tattva vidas tattvam yat jnanam advayam Brahmeti Paramatmeti Bhagavan iti shabdate. So those who are knowers of the truth, tattvavid, they say that the absolute truth is realized in three ways: Brahman, Paramatma, Bhagavan. These are the three understandings of the absolute truth. Now, what are these three different understandings? For that also, there are analogies given in our scriptures. Our scriptures explain things through analogies. Many a times we find so many analogies, because to understand spiritual subject matters, it is very difficult for us. We may say Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagavan, very difficult to understand what is that, unless one has reached to that stage, because that's altogether a different world. So our scriptures give examples so that we get some understanding of things. For example, to explain the concept of reincarnation, the analogy of changing the cloth has been given. Just like we are wearing a cloth, when the cloth is torn or old, then what do? We throw away, we reject this cloth and put on a new cloth. So through this analogy, it has been explained that when this body is like a cloth to the soul, so when this body becomes old and torn, then the soul rejects this body and moves on to another body. So like this, this is an analogy. Upama de karke, udaharan se samjhate hain. Similarly, to explain these three understandings of Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagavan, the analogy of sun has been given. So we see the sun. Suppose someone has always lived in dark, and then one day he has never experienced sunlight, and one day he opens the window, or he comes out of his room and sees, oh, everywhere there is light. He comes from darkness to light. So he says, oh, this is blissful, this is wonderful. So that is one understanding of the sun, through sunlight. Someone may be more intelligent and may ask, but where is this sunlight coming from? Then a person may look up and see, oh, this is coming from the sun. So this sunlight, this understanding of sunlight, this is also the understanding of sun, but to a certain degree. We are not, we know that there is light, but we don't know what is the source of light. So a person who understands, oh, it's coming from the sun, so that's a Paramatma realization. When one understands there is a localized source from where it's coming. And then someone may be more intelligent and may ask, oh, what is there inside the sun planet? There is a whole, this sun is a whole planet, and there is a whole kingdom inside that. Sun God is there, and many other demigods, many other people are there on the sun planet. It's altogether a different world. They have different type of bodies. So the one who can understand sun God, that is a Bhagwan realization. Understands the more details. And then one can have a personal relationship with sun God. So understanding of sunlight, the sun planet and the sun God is compared with Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagavan. This is one analogy. Let us take one more example. Sometimes it is said that in India, I have heard this story, when Britishers were here, they first started this train in India. So villagers, they made the train line. Villagers didn't know anything about train. They had never seen what is a train. So it was announced that today first train is going to come and pass through your village. Then all the villagers, they gathered around the platform to see what is this, what does this train look like. They had seen bullock carts, but they never knew what is a train. So they were waiting with a lot of eagerness to see what is a sun. So when they heard some sound first from a far distant, and when the train started to come a little closer, then they saw the headlight. And from a far distance, especially in the evenings, the only thing that you can see is the light. In the front engine, there is a big light, and that you can see from a far distance. So when they saw, oh, that is the train. So what is their understanding of the train? What is the realization of the train? Oh, that light. They have not seen the train. They have no idea what train looks like. But as soon as they see the light, someone tells, oh, that is the train. So that is those category of people who have Brahman realization. So Brahma Jyoti is the effulgence, the light coming from Krishna, coming from the spiritual world. Since the light is coming and they see that light, so that is also one aspect of the train. That light is not false. It's one aspect of the train, but that is not complete understanding of the train. That is partial understanding of the train. Now after some time, the train comes closer, and then some people, they see how the engine looks like from outside. There is a glass window and some details, some features they see, okay, and this looks this big. So some idea, some more clarity they get. So that is like Paramatma realization. And when the train comes on the platform, oh, there are people inside. There are seats. There is a berth to sleep. There is also a place to keep luggage. Oh, there is a fan also and light also. And there are some people who are serving some fruits, some chana, some snacks, water bottles. There is a whole life inside it. So it's a whole life inside the train. Everything is there. There's a washroom, vendors coming, going, police also, some one or two walking, security system is also there. So the person sees all the details. So that is like Bhagavan realization, when one has understood in more detail everything. So similarly, Brahman realization is the realization of the Brahma Jyoti, the effulgence, the light, the divine light that comes out from the spiritual world. Then Paramatma realization is those yogis who meditate on God as the super soul seated in the heart of everyone. That is Paramatma realization. And Bhagavan is a personal realization when one understands the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Krishna, as a person having all personal features and qualities. So spiritual world is there where there is a full life, spiritual life, with all variegatedness, with all activities, filled with eternity, knowledge and blissfulness. So that is Bhagavan realization. So all three are the understandings of the Absolute Truth, but there is still difference between the three. So a person who has seen just the light of the train, he also has understood something about the train. Someone who has seen a little closer look, and someone who knows what is all inside the train. So all three have, but then there is a degree of understanding. Someone knows a lot more about it, someone knows very little about it. Similarly, so that is what has been explained in this verse, where Krishna says that I am the source of this Brahman. The Brahman, these impersonalists who do not believe or accept the personal form of the Lord, they only accept that the Brahma is the highest, Brahman. Krishna is saying that I am the source of that Brahman. That Brahman comes from me. Brahmano hi pratistha aham. Pratistha means the base, the rest. Brahman is the rests in me. So Krishna is telling that I am the ultimate absolute truth. That's what he is telling. Then there are constitution of this Brahman has been given in this verse, saying that the immortal, imperishable, eternal, these are all the different qualities of the Brahman. See, everything has got some characteristics by which we know it. The constitution is a very solid word. Something constitution, it means what all it's made up of. So if we look at any material object, we can tell that this is constituted of so and so. We say like that. For example, sweetness is the constitutional position of sugar. Sugar will have sweetness. Liquidity is part of water. Water has liquidity. So liquidity is constitution of water. So water has this quality of liquidity. Sugar has this quality of sweetness. Salt has this quality of salty, being salty, like this. This is something that cannot be separated from it. That is called constitution. You cannot take it out. From water, you cannot take out liquidity. Water is there, it will be liquid. Sugar is there, it's going to be sweet. You cannot take out sweetness from the sugar. Then it's not sugar anymore. If you take out sweetness, it's no more sugar. So it's like in gradient of it's like you cannot separate it from this. That is called constitution. Similarly, for the living entity, our constitution is that we are part and parcel of Krishna. That is our constitutional position. Which is something that cannot be separated. We cannot be separated from Krishna. We are His part and parcel eternally. Krishna says, Mama evansho jiva loke jiva bhuta sanatana. Sanatana means eternally we are part and parcel of Krishna. That is our constitution. We are made like that. Krishna's constitution is Sachidananda Vigraha. From Krishna you can never take out eternity, knowledge and blissfulness. That is Krishna. The absolute truth means Satchit Ananda. It cannot be separated out. So the constitution similarly of this Brahman has been given is immortality. It's a very different constitution. Here we have this house, has so many ingredients. The marble is there, the cement is there, that's all its constitution. But the Brahman's constitution is immortality, imperishability and happiness. Imagine something which is made up of happiness. We have no experience of that here. Something which is made of happiness. We come in contact with that, we will be happy. Something that is immortal, we have no experience of that here in this world. Man is mortal, we hear. In this material world, you see anything, there is nothing that has been existing from eternity. Everything, anything we can take, it came into existence at some point in time. And it will be there for some time and after that it will vanish. I will vanish, all of us will vanish one day. This house will also vanish. This tube light, this fan, everything will one day vanish. So there is nothing here that we experience which is immortal. So all the three, four things that are mentioned here, they are beyond our experience. Immortality, imperishability. Everything here in this world is subject to decay. This table is there like this, after a few years it will start to wear off. It needs to be painted and paint will come out, something will happen. It's not imperishable, this is perishable. But Brahman is imperishable. Here everything will die one day. But Brahman is immortal. And here everything is miserable. Everything is filled with misery. The constitution, what is the constitution of this world? Janma Mrityu Jara Vyadhi. That is the constitution of this world. This world has been constituted like that. Janma Mrityu Jara Vyadhi. Birth, death, old age and disease. These four things are there in this world. And those four things can never be, these four problems can never be solved. In this world, there will never be a time when this world will be free from death, free from birth, free from old age and free from disease. The diseases were there earlier, they are here now and they will be there in the future. No matter how much advancement medical science makes, how many hospitals are opened, doesn't matter, that will be there. Once somebody asks Prabhupada, in London, the mortality rate is very high in India. Mortality rate is very high in India. Prabhupada said, wherever I have gone, mortality rate is same everywhere. It's 100%. It's 100% everywhere. So people everywhere, everybody will die. So this world is filled with that. This is the constitution of this world. So constitution of this world is birth, death, old age and disease. The constitution of Brahman is immortality, imperishability, eternality and happiness. We can see the contrast. It's very different. So what we are talking about here is something beyond this world. Cannot be compared with anything in this world, because there is nothing in this world that satisfies these qualities, which possesses these qualities. There is nothing in this world. Brahman is the effulgence coming out from Krishna, who is Satchidananda Vigraha. So this is Brahman. So here Krishna is talking about, and we can attain to this goal, we can attain to that state by following the process of devotional service. That is what has been described here. So one who has the understanding of Bhagavan as a personal form of the Lord and has developed a relationship with the Lord is considered to have already understood and realized Paramatma and Brahman. That is already included. But someone who has realized Brahman, that person has no understanding of Paramatma and Bhagavan. So it's like Bhagavan is already a superset of the other two. So it's like if someone has 1 lakh rupees, that person already has 1,000 rupees and already has 10 rupees, is already included in that. But someone who has 10 rupees, he doesn't have 1 lakh rupees. But if I have 1 lakh, then I already have 10. 10 is already part of 1 lakh. But 1 lakh is not part of 10. So there is a difference in this way. So Brahman realization is the first stage, Paramatma is the second stage, and Bhagavan is the last stage, ultimate goal of life. And there are many personalities who earlier attained Brahman realization, but later, after coming in contact with pure devotees, they understood the Supreme Personality of Godhead and went ahead and became a devotee, went to the Bhagavan realization. The examples here in this purport is given of 4 Kumaras, the children, the sons of Lord Brahma. Earlier they were situated in impersonal understanding of the Absolute Truth, but having come in contact with the devotees, they became attracted, they got attracted. When they reached to the Vaikuntha, and then having smelt the tulasi and flowers, and having come in contact with devotees, they became attracted to the Krishna. And then in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes also we see many personalities who were earlier situated in impersonal understanding, but having received the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they became attracted to the devotional service of Krishna and they became devotees. Great examples, Sarvam Bhattacharya. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Puri, they had some discussion. And then, by the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he became a wonderful devotee. Prakashananda Saraswati, with all his sannyasi disciples, they all were followers of impersonal feature of the Absolute Truth. So they received the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and they became devotees. All living entities are spirit souls. So this phrase in our scriptures, that aham brahmasmi, is I am Brahman, is true. The Brahman means we are spirit soul. But Krishna is Parabrahman. He is the supreme soul, super soul. So everybody is Brahman. Everybody is spirit soul, but everybody is at the same time part and parcel of the super soul. So that relation is there. The difference in Brahman realization and Bhagavan is that in Brahman realization there is no relationship. The living entity leaves this body, having become totally detached, and then as a spark goes and dwells and lives in the effulgence of the Lord. There is no relationship with anybody. So that state is not a permanent state. There is a chance of coming down from there. But when one has established and developed a loving relationship with the Lord, then there is no chance of coming back. Yat gatva na nivartante tad dhamo paramam mama. There is no happiness without relationships. Even in this world we see, we all need relationships. Nobody can live completely alone without interacting with anybody. No speaking, no talking, nothing, nothing to do with anybody. Nobody can live. We all need relationships. But the problem here in this world is that all relationships are temporary. There is always a fear of losing that relationship. For whatever reasons, there are for reasons beyond our control. Anytime anything can happen, there is always a fear. Because the relationships in this world, they are based on body. And body is subject to destruction. So there is always a fear in our relationships in this world. But when the relationship is based on the understanding that we are eternal spirit souls and we are part and parcel of Krishna, and Krishna is at the center of all our relationships, then there is no fear of losing that relationships, because that relationship is permanent. That is eternal relationship. And that is our ultimate goal of life, to re-establish actually our relationship with God and all the living entities together connected with Krishna. And in that relationship there is a lot of exchange of feelings, thoughts, services. So there is joy, there is happiness. Krishna has unlimited relationships with unlimited people. And he is capable of sustaining all these relationships, maintaining all these relationships. He is infinite Lord. When we hear about him more and more, we develop attraction towards him. We develop detachment from this worldly things, and in this way we come closer and closer to the Lord. And the process of establishing our relationship is mentioned here in the last paragraph of this verse. The whole process of devotional service Srila Prabhupada has given, that one should always engage in the service of the Lord. One should eat the remnants of food offered to the deity, means always take prasadam, and then follow the process of chanting, hearing and remembering, shravanam, kirtanam, vishnu, smaranam, pada sevanam. So these processes, about hearing, like we are doing now, hearing about Krishna, books are there, reading about Krishna. Then remember, when we hear and read, then we are going to remember also. Sometimes those thoughts will come. So by this process, associating with devotees, visiting the places where Lord Krishna performed his pastimes, participating in Krishna's festivals, like Janmashtami is coming very soon, Jhulan Yatra is coming very soon, Balram's appearance day, Krishna's appearance day, participating in those festivals. By all these processes, we re-establish our relationship with the Lord, and we can attain to the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is our ultimate goal, and that is the ultimate resting place from where, which is free from birth, which is free from death, which is free from old age, free from disease. The spiritual world is not afflicted with any of these problems of this world. There, the soul lives in pure relationship with the Lord and lives blissfully, because that is the constitution of the living entity. We belong to that abode of Krishna, where one has the association of Krishna all the time, and one is engaged in his service, one is fully surrendered, and then that is a blissful state. We do not belong to this world, we are in the wrong place. So our problems here in this world can never be solved. We can never address all our problems in this world. There will always be, because this place is like that, it has been made like that. So while we continue with our duties in this world, we should always endeavor to progress towards the ultimate goal of life, which is to develop a loving relationship with the Lord. Because without relationship with the Lord, there is no happiness. So this is the last verse of this chapter. I will read the translation. I will read the translation of the previous verse and this verse together. One who engages in full devotional service, unfailing in all circumstances, at once transcends the modes of nature and thus comes to the level of Brahman. And I am the basis of the impersonal Brahman, which is immortal, imperishable and eternal, and is the constitutional position of the ultimate happiness. These two verses are connected. That is, by the process of devotional service, one can transcend these modes of material nature. Mode of goodness, passion and ignorance, one can get out of it and attain to the lotus feet of Krishna. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai, Shri Prabhupada ki jai, Hare Krishna. So if anyone has any questions or comments, if you have microphone, you can pass. There is this phone, is there? So the question is, what is the destination of the devotees? Where do devotees go? Right? Yes, Krishna has told many times in Bhagavad Gita, I read that verse also. And Krishna says that those who antakale cha mameva smaran muktva kalevaram yah prayati samadbhavam tadabhadbhava bhavita. So Krishna says that those who leave this body remembering me, they attain to my abode. Beyond this material world, like this is a material world, beyond this, there is a spiritual world. That world is very different world. That is what we were studying today. That world is filled with that, the nature of that world is immortal, immortality, imperishable, happiness. So, and there are many planets in that world. So depending on the relationship and the bhava that the devotee has, they reach to that destination. Those who have developed loving relationship with Lord Krishna in that form, they will go to Goloka Vrindavan in spiritual world. Lord, the Hanumanji is devotee of Lord Ram. There is an abode, Saket Dham, in spiritual world. So Hanumanji lives there, but Hanumanji at the same time can also be in this world also if Lord Ram wants him to be here. So basically a devotee means one who has fully surrendered to the desire of Krishna, desire of the Lord. See, he doesn't mind where he is. Wherever Lord places him, he is there. He will be happy wherever. So that is the destination. We want, it is a planet. It is a planet, but it's a spiritual planet. It's not a planet like this. Like this is a material planet, which is made with earth, fire, water, air and ether. That's a spiritual planet, and we won't be able to understand everything about that planet because our consciousness is totally material. So there is very subtle and this very subtle concepts. So once we, right now, our what we need to do is we need to understand that we are here in this material world. Our consciousness is material right now. So we need to rise from this level by taking the process of devotional service. And once we rise, then we will be able to see the things that are beyond this. It's just like this, right? I am here and I am driving. In the night, I am going on the road, right? With the light of my car, the headlight, I can only see maximum half kilometer or 1 kilometer. I can't see more than that. But I continue to move as I go further, and then I will be able to see more. So everything will not be visible to us right now because our consciousness is engrossed in this material world. So we need to follow the process of devotional service to elevate ourselves from totally material understanding to a spiritual understanding, and then other things then will become clear. Yes. Yes. So many places, Chintamani Prakara, whole Brahma Samhita is there. In Srimad Bhagavatam it's there, Bhagavad Gita it's there. Chintamani Prakara Sadma Sukalpa Viksha Laksha Vriteshu Surabhi Lavipalayantam Lakshmi Sahasra Sata Sambrahma Sebhyamanam Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. The planets of spiritual planet, the houses there, they are made from touchstone. The trees are desire trees. All those descriptions are there in our scriptures.
So can I add one?
Yes.
Shvetadeep,
yes.
This is what he is asking.
Shvetadeep is there.
Realization of God, realization of God, realization of Brahman, Paramatma, created or not, whether this realization of Bhagavan, Paramatma, is confined to Hinduism or it is it universal?
It's universal. Universal.
It is universal. And this is possible through our belief in the Krishna consciousness.
Yes. Yes. So his question is whether the attainment of these destinations of Bhagavan, Paramatma is confined to Hinduism or anybody can do it. So first of all, what we are studying, Bhagavad Gita, is not Hinduism. This is eternal dharma. This is eternal knowledge. Hinduism is a term that has been given to the followers who are living in this region by somebody, but our religion is a Shashwat, eternal religion. And the process is to chant the holy name of the Lord in this world. Anybody can chant and follow the process, take the name of God. Prabhupada said, those who are Christians, he said that you chant your names, whatever names you have. You chant purely, follow the principles of religion. So, if one purely chants the name of God, then one can attain to these goals. And here in this Kali Yuga, as we read here, the process, the main process of developing that relationship is chanting the holy name, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Whenever, wherever we have time, we should chant these names. And these chanting these names will help us understand. Many of these things will be revealed to us within the heart through this process of chanting. This is very powerful process.
You know, in other religions, they don't believe in form. Christianity, Muslims, they don't believe in form. Mm.
There is some understanding of the form of the God in other religions also. Some of them they don't have, but some of them they do have. But they don't have the level of details that we have. In some of them, there is some mention of the form of the Lord. Like it is said in Christianity, the man is made in the image of God. So these things are there, and there is also some mention, but not to the level of details that are there in our eternal scriptures of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. So at this point, our goal should be, first let us understand the basic things, that I am not this body. I am different from this body. The body will perish. I will have to move on to another body. Let us first get this understanding clear by the process of chanting. And once these understandings are ingrained in us, other things will become clear a little later.
Right.
So, yes, Prabhuji.
No, yes, three more from material lecture. We have to transcript this three more of lecture you were speaking. And you were speaking that there is a pastime from God, now there must be something. Whether he visited all the pastimes of Lord Krishna where he has done this activities.
So what do you recommend if we skip to this 65-66 sloka and just surrender to the Lord, that is sufficient, or still we have to follow the instruction that going all the different places past the Lord?
Hare Krishna. See, in this regard, we all should follow some authority in our life. We don't decide everything on our own. There are so many instructions in our scriptures. Everybody cannot follow everything. And so that is why we have our spiritual masters or whoever our authority is, and we are engaged in the service. So whatever service is given to us, we accept that and do that. Certain things are common for everybody, like chanting our minimum whatever number of rounds, attending morning Mangalarati, some things are common, and other than that, it's all depends on whatever service we are engaged in. So that is, that takes priority. So we should follow that, and that is the best. See, the thing is, surrendering is not is easier said than done. So we may say so that I am chanting and I am surrendered, but it's a very, it takes mercy, it requires mercy of Krishna and Guru. So in the heart, in the deep core of the heart, we are totally feeling that dependency on Krishna. So, until we have reached to a very high stage where we can completely live in bhajan 24 hours a day, like Haridas Thakur, who hardly slept for 1 hour and he could do that, I don't think anybody is capable of doing that. So for us, because we are in sadhakas and we need to purify ourselves, so it's important that we stick to the instructions of our spiritual masters and our guides, and we remain engaged in the service, and by doing that service, slowly we become purified. And Krishna sees that we are dedicated, and we are, so he gives his blessings. So, yes, bro. Yeah. Yes.
Being in Satoguna also material?
Yes. Satoguna is also material. Because in this chapter it is said that Satoguna also binds one. Satoguna also keeps us in this material world. If we are in Satoguna but not a devotee, then what happens? We may go, we will do Punya Karma. By Punya Karma, we are going to get pious good results. Then when good results come, good results when we get more money, comfortable life and all that, then tendency to enjoy develops. We want to enjoy when we have lot of opulence, then again sinful activity starts. So that goes in cycles. By Punya Karma, we may get to heavenly planets, but not to the spiritual world. So that is why Satoguna is also material. Satoguna, Rajoguna, Tamoguna, all three are material. They are gunas of this world, they are called modes of material nature. So material nature, so all three are material. But if someone is in Satoguna but a devotee, then that is transcendental, that is becomes a spiritual. Okay. Thank you, Hare Krishna.